I'm Dr. John Iskander. Welcome to CDC Beyond the Data. In association with today's encore presentation on nanotechnology for Public Health Grand Rounds, we're very pleased to have Dr. Paul Schulte joining us from CDC's National Institute for Occupational Safety and Health. Paul, could you reorient our audience a little bit to nanotechnology, as nanotechnology has now moved from science fiction very much into the real world? When we say nanotechnology, how small is small, and what kinds of industries are we talking about?
Well, one nanometer is the size of 10 hydrogen atoms put side by side. So you get the idea that we're talking about something that's extremely small, something that's generally only visible by electron microscopes. So 10 hydrogen atoms side by side would be one nanometer. If you recall from the presentation that I did, as you cut matter down from large pieces to small pieces, when you get down around 60 nanometers, you start to see new scientific properties. Things are more conductive, they're more magnetic, they're stronger, they're more reactive, and you can do a lot of things with that, and you can make a lot of different products. And so nanotechnology really pervades almost all industrial sectors. And essentially, nanomaterials will be in almost every kind of product that's manufactured in the future. Right now, we see nanomaterials in automobile side panels. We see them in clothes. We see them in concrete, in food, in every different kind of electronics that you can think of. So there's a wide range of uses of nanomaterials. And they're also used in medicine as possible ways of reaching target cells specifically without hurting the surrounding area.
So very much a part of everyday life, and moving into more almost science fiction-like applications. And I think you did a very good job of talking about why we might want to use some of these materials, some of the benefits. But I understand that there are also concerns for some of the workers exposed to these materials. Can you tell me a little bit about what we've learned about that, and maybe some of what we still have to learn?
Well, we're about 10 years into the commercialization of nanotechnology. So in the 90s, there was a lot of research, but products started coming out in the late 90s, early 2000s. We're now at 2013. There's one source that says there's over 1,600 commercial products that are on the market. Workers have to make all those products. Workers are also the people who do the research. So all along the life cycle of nanomaterials, from the laboratory to manufacture, to taking the manufactured nanomaterials and putting them in something, to the end of life, workers are involved. So over these last 10 years, we're starting to see a number of things. We're starting to see, one, a buildup of scientific literature showing that certain nanomaterials can be hazardous. And just to remind you, when we talk about nanomaterials, there's a universe of potential types of nanomaterials. So there's not just one. They're all different sizes and shapes and have different surface characteristics. So it's hard. The language makes it difficult to talk about them because it's not one entity. It's a diversity of entities. But in the last 10 years, some types of nanomaterials have been shown to be hazards in animal studies. Also in the last 10 years, we're starting to see literature that shows occupational exposures are occurring in various industries. There are no known human cases of disease as a result of exposure to nanomaterials at this point. So we're making all our judgments off of extrapolating from animal studies. What we've seen in animal studies is that some nanomaterials cause respiratory problems. They can have cardiovascular effects. They can certainly, we're concerned in the occupational environment of them being breathed in, and then they can get into the blood, they can get into the systemic organs. But mostly what we've seen are respiratory and cardiovascular effects that are of the greatest concern in the animals, and we project that they could be, that workers exposed to these materials could have risks of those effects.
Okay, so for workers in these industries, or for, you know, people in public health or in clinical medicine, dealing with these workers, dealing with these occupational health issues, are there some prevention or remediation strategies that seem reasonable given the admittedly incomplete state of evidence? Are there some prevention measures?
Yes, we've had over 100 years dealing with fine dusts and powders in industry, thinking of ways to control them, particularly in the pharmaceutical industry where we have biologically active dusts and powders. We know how to control these kinds of materials, so that's the good news. While there may be some potential hazard with some types of nanomaterials, we generally know how to control them. They follow the same laws of aerosol physics that any other particle does. In some cases, they even behave as gases. But in both cases, we know how to control them as a gas or as a particle. And so, indeed, we can use what we've learned over the last 100 years and control most kinds of operations. Now, the thing is, we don't know specifically if there are any limitations to that, any factors that might make that more difficult. But our best assessment thus far is that these are controllable in most situations.
Are we talking about things like shielding, respiratory protection? Are these the type of measures we're talking about?
Precisely. Enclosures, ventilation, personal protective equipment. In some cases, nanomaterials are shielded from the workers because of need for pristine environments for them to exist in. So that also has the benefit of protecting the workers. But we know that we can make enclosures of processes, we can use ventilation, different kinds of ventilation, and that we can use personal protective equipment.
So, I mean, really, just a fascinating topic. For those in our audience who want, you know, more detailed information, can you recommend a couple of sources for them to seek out?
Well, certainly if you go on the CDC website and click on nanotechnology and access the NIOSH pages on nanotechnology, you'll get all the work that we've done, including a progress report that we've published last December on all our progress made since 2004. So that's a good overview. We also have other kinds of reports, so that would be a good place to start, and that also links to other organizations that will have information as well.
Thank you very much, Dr. Schulte. Please join us next month for another segment of CDC's Beyond the Data. Thank you for joining us.